Okay, so everybody, it's time for the debut of Wild Pitches with Aris. I'm Mick at Smokies Stadium, FanFest 2023. And here we are, man. I mean, this is the podcast that everyone said they wanted.
You know, and it's not an April Fool joke either. You know, today's April 1st, but we're kicking off something fun, and it's going to be glorious, I believe. I mean, more time that we get to hear your voice, the better. So.
I know, I've got to do like the broadcast your voice. That's right, Aris. You know, thank you for being here today, and don't forget to tip your bartenders. Don't forget to tip your bartenders. Talking about tipping your bartenders, George Yardley. Going Yardley segment on the show.
Definitely going to be a fan favorite.
That's a big part of anything that you do. Anytime you come out here, you hear George's voice, which is always amusing. But the guy behind the voice is one of a kind.
Yeah, to say the very least.
What's it like working with him?
Oh, every day is the holiday. You know, you don't know how exactly he's going to be ready to go for a game. Sometimes he's reporting all about baseball, has this book from like 1950s Major League Baseball trivia. Then the next day, it looks like he has no idea what's going on out there. So it's a mixed bag, but honestly, it keeps me on my toes. So I've got to love it.
Yeah, he's been a fixture, and he loves the team. So I saw him taking notes, like he was going to come on here, and there was like something that was happening that I didn't even tell him what we were talking about. So I'm like kind of curious, like what notes do you have that you think that you need to take for this podcast?
Not to mention that it's on a yellow leaked pad. I think he's the only one that's buying those.
He's not only the voice in Smokies Stadium, but he's also the voice of Leonard Slew. Like he talks his college football stuff. So
we have plenty of time to go into that.
Yeah, we're in the batter's box. Make sure that you guys hang out with us. SmokiesBaseball.com on Twitter, and they'll be part of it. I can't believe, first off, that the season's here. I mean, like, it's kind of hard to believe. Like, and I feel like we just walked out of Game 3 of the championship series. Obviously, a tough loss. You know, and then now we're back at it again.
It's really glorious, to be honest. You know, it's really fun to be back at the ballpark. And what a crowd we have in attendance today for our fans, as we just started things about a half hour ago. And, wow, it seems like the people are also ready for baseball.
Yeah. For those of you that are here right now, you know that it's very sunny, but it's also blustery. I almost flew out into the stands, you know, walking onto the concourse.
It's because of all that weight that you lost over the winter time there, man.
I don't know where. I don't know if that's true at all. I mean, like, I try to lose weight, but what'd you do in the off season?
I gained weight.
Did you?
I guess I enjoyed myself, you know, not working the typical 9 a.m. to midnight every day like we are about to begin here April through September. But, you know, had a lot of fun, went back home in New Jersey, my roots, went to New York City with a girlfriend, and, you know, went to a bunch of different things. So got to see a very exciting concert actually last week.
Who?
I think you've heard about him. No, I actually saw him at Bridgestone Arena, and that's the one and only John Mayer.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
So was it John Mayer, like, with Dead Company, or was it just John Mayer?
No, actually, it was a concert tour that he has going on right now called John Mayer Solo.
Okay.
And all he's doing is singing and playing the guitar. No background instruments, no band, just him. The gal pal is a big fan of John Mayer. This is her second time seeing him. And, you know, when she invited me, I'm like, oh, yeah. You know, big Grateful Dead guy there. And it was so interesting just to see in this huge venue him just singing like kind of just like he's in his basement. You know,
so was it, did he play any of the Dead songs, or was it more like it was like My Body's a Wonderland?
Oh yeah, and, yeah. That, you know, it was his
hits. His stuff. Huh?
So yeah.
Well, the Dead and Company's like Oh, like it's their last year. It's this season that they're going on tour. And I think part of that is that I kind of feel like for him, he's probably like, you know what, I'm ready to do something else.
So that starts like in May or so, is that correct?
Yeah, yeah. So this is it. It'll be a lot of fun. I mean, Bob Weir's like 75, so he's kind of up there. And, you know, you're down to a few members of the original Grateful Dead.
Sure.
You know? And John Mayer doing it, I mean, he's been really surprisingly amazing. I first got to know John Mayer when he was on the Chappelle Show. You know, he was on the Chappelle Show, and Dave Chappelle would have him on there, and he was like, you know, when there's guitar, white people dance, and that's what happened. You know, like he would, John Mayer would play guitar, it's really funny. And then, you know, like they're like, hey, he's doing Dead & Company now. I'm a huge Jerry Garcia guy, and I'm like, what's this going to be like, you know, like, my body's a wonderland, you know, this stuff, and he came on, and he was fantastic, like, he's such a great performer.
With you being such the deadhead that you are, how many times have you seen Dead & Company?
Yeah, I mean, I've seen him, you know, as many times as I can. Like, last year I saw him four times.
Just last year
saw him? Yeah, just last
four
year.
Four times.
And I'm kind of, like, looking at the schedule this year and, like, already, like, kind of, like, the schedule comes out and I look at where the Smokies are going to be and then, you know, kind of what I'm doing. You know, last year I went to Wrigley, which was a bucket list thing, and I saw him back-to-back nights up there with some of my good friends.
Nice check mark.
Cincinnati was fantastic.
Love that city.
Yeah, that was one of the best concerts that I've been to. And Atlanta, a big group of my friends went to Atlanta the last time, so I want to go back to there. I want to go back to Cincinnati. I want to go to Fenway.
I've never been to Fenway. Definitely on the bucket list just to watch a baseball game, but to see a concert, especially one of your favorite bands out there, would be so cool.
Yeah, I saw them in Red Rocks. That was kind of spiritual.
Spiritual, man.
Like, I mean, like, if you're going to see a band out there, and everybody from Colorado is like, you got to go see, you know, a band, and it's like, yeah, we did that.
Good vibes.
It was cool. Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm a big craft beer drinker, and it's like a place where they do a lot of really cool things with beer, and the environment was great, and, you know, it just was the experience that I thought it would be, you know. So I guess that kind of leads us to, like, one of the topics we want to get into, and that's our Grateful Dead night. It'll be our third one that we've done, and I guess second annual, right? Because we did
second
it last
annual.
Year, and so we did it in, like, 2015, and then we did it last year, and then we're doing it again. I've been impressed by the support that the Smokies fans have given to the Grateful Dead night.
There's so many fans that came out to the ballpark last year that have never been out to a game, which is definitely, you know, one of my goals of, you know, the job that I have is, you know, bringing people to the ballpark. It's not about the baseball game, you know, it's all about creating memories that last a lifetime.
Right.
And there's so
sounds
many
like
people.
That sounds like a campaign.
Well, you know, it's one of my trademarks there. So
creating memories that last a lifetime.
Yes. Yeah.
No, but I'm seriously, you are right, though. I mean, that's kind of what you do, right?
And, you know, these deadheads, as you can attest to, you know, they are die hard. And they will go to wherever something involving Grateful Dead is going to be. And, you know, this past season, we had not only a really sick-looking jersey that went to a great cause, Rural Area Medical, but, you know, we had the music going, we had the fun in-between inning contest that just kept the night rolling, and of course we had the great concert at the conclusion of the game.
We did it before and after. You know, you guys did such a good job of, like, getting the word out on the street, you know. And I just thought that I didn't know what to expect, you know, because we pitch these ideas. What people don't know is we pitch all these ideas during the, you know, the off season, or things that we think might work. And I'm like, hey, we should do a Grateful Dead night, you know. And it's not like an original idea. I mean, I'm stealing it straight from the San Francisco Giants. Cubs do one, you know, Phillies do one, a lot of teams do it. But the Giants have done it since Jerry Garcia was alive. And because they were, you know, they were big Giants fans in San Francisco. They sung the national anthem before games. And, that's where they were founded, out in San Francisco. And I thought, we should do this, you know, because everyone everywhere I go, I run into people that really like the Grateful Dead. And,
yeah.
And the first time we did it was before you worked here, and it did okay. You know, like we did okay. But last year it was like, let's bring it back. The jerseys, you can't even find the original jersey anymore.
I know, that's the thing. You know,
it's sought after.
And it goes hand in hand. You know, a nice little play on words with our team being the Smokies.
Yeah.
So
I said that too. Yeah.
Well, yeah. Well, trust me.
That's
yeah,
what I was like, hey, dude, we're the Smokies. But the first jersey sold out, and you can't get them. And then, you know, last year we did one, and it blew out. And I thought what was really cool about last year was working with Greg Gordon, who's one of the concert poster guys that does the concert posters for the Dead & Company and other bands and stuff. And then the t-shirts were gone before the first pitch. And
that's the thing. Yeah, absolutely. You
know, posters were great.
The thing that's another thing that makes the Grateful Dead so unique is because the fans love to collect these posters,
right,
you know, as mementos. You know, it's like one thing if it's a pin or a pen or something, like some type of a souvenir,
right,
but these are things that people collect and they show off. And at the end of the day, you know, you couldn't make a monopoly, and then you're just selling them online and creating a whole bunch of bank off of it.
Well, this is, what was cool is like that poster turned out amazing. The t-shirt was great. Like, just having that in my house, and I'm like a part of that. You know, like it's just. And then so this year, I don't know how we're going to eat that. You know, like, and so Justin Helton, who's a local artist that does Dead & Company stuff, that's what we've been talking about, and you know, we'll see what happens. But whoever's job it is to try to beat that is going to have to really climb the ladder to beat that. I mean, that poster, like, I remember opening it up from, like, the, you know, you get these giant, like, it's like, I would say almost like a pallet of these things in there, and you open it up, and
it's like an artist pad.
Yeah, right. Like, oh my God, like, the paper's so thick, and it's, you know, the coloring is like, it's all screen printed, so it's it just has that, it really pops. And just knowing, like, man, we did something very cool. And then, how do you go back the next year and kind of duplicate that or beat that? But that's what the goal is. I mean, that's kind of what we do with every promotion.
You're absolutely right. And it's all about how can we make it bigger and better and unique. Just as you said, Grateful Dead, you know, that is a theme night that's been done for years. But how can we do a twist on it and make it fun and unique and have people talk about it down the road to share with their friends and really get the hype up for especially our second year in a row now?
Man, I've been in this position since 2007. I've been here a long time.
Woof.
I mean, like, I know, think about that, dude. I mean, I've been here a long, long time. And one of the advantages of that is that, you know, you do have a say on stuff like this. You're like, hey, you know, this is something that is important to me. It's something that I really like, and I'd love to, like, share that with the community and see if they, you know, if they're going to be a part of that. And there's just so much pride I have when we had Stolen Faces out of Nashville. They played for us. They did a set before the game, which Tim Volk was like, we should do this. We should get them to play a set before the game. We did it with some of our other acts too, and it's great. You know, it's like people show up. And
it definitely works.
Like,
works.
You know, you're hanging out. You know, the game hadn't started yet. You have a beer. You know, listen to a set. But what was amazing about this, and I think that the bands that we have, our Elvis was fantastic. I mean,
we'll,
like,
talk about that.
We really had some cool, like, you guys don't even know, like, as you're, you know, you're listening right now, there's a lot of competition. I mean, we want these, internally, we want these to be really good, you know, and we want these things to be something that you guys come out and go, you know what, man, I had a kick-ass time. And
that's the goal.
Yeah, right. Like you said, you know, before. Well, Christian is the lead singer of the Stolen Faces, and he's like, hey, you know, if you want, make a set list for the concert, you know, and I'm like,
how about that?
Oh, it's a dream come true. Every Dead fan's like they want to do this, you know, because there's so many songs and there's so many different eras. I mean, you're talking about a band that started in the 60s and finished up in the 90s, and there were they weren't a big commercial success, but they were a real American success, you know. And they're the technology that we have now better suits what they do. Mm-hmm. You know, where you can have like a 13-minute song. Well, you would get like a record, and I'm getting an idea. I got a Skinner record for my birthday, or no, for Father's Day, and.
Oh boy, there's that memory going away.
Recently, no. I mean, and the second side of one of the albums is Freebird.
The whole album,
you know? So think about this. Like, that's like a, you know, how long, 13-minute version of Freebird or 15 or whatever for Skinner. You know, it's the same thing. And as I say that, look, Aris, somebody's wearing one of the dead shirts right outside.
Dude, it never fails. It literally never fails, no matter where you go. Yeah. So,
when you get to make the set list, like, that is a bucket list thing. So I'm here, and all the Smokies Dead fans showed up, and I'm like, just floored, man, because, you know, you promoted it, I'm out promoting it, we're talking about it all the time, we're begging people to come out and be a part of what we're doing. And it was like, just when those gates opened and I saw all those people coming like towards the stage, man, I got chills telling you, man. I was so proud of what we were able to accomplish. You know, your guys, my guys, like the entire team, our community, because I knew at that point, like, this could be an amazing night. And then they start playing these songs I picked, you know?
Right, right.
So somebody, I'm talking to some deadheads, and I'm like, they're like,
what'd you think of the playlist, bro?
Yeah, I'm like, yo, I made the playlist, dude. And I'm like, hey, man, do you like the playlist? I said, I start, like, you know, pull up the list that I sent Christian, and those guys, in Stolen Faces are amazing musicians.
Very,
amazing.
Very good.
Like, they can do music outside of the Dead, but they do that. They tour all around doing it. So that's a special day. That's on July 8th this year, so we got a ways to go before it comes, but that was really, to me, like one of the best nights in the entire year. I really loved that.
It was definitely unique. You know, it takes you away from just the baseball game. It had this fun, unique atmosphere, and, you know, just as you could agree with this, some people showed up to the ballpark and had no idea that was going to take place. And what do you think their reactions were to all
of that?
What
the hell's this?
Who is Bertha?
There's a band over here. Whatever. No, I'm with you on that. Like, okay. The difference between, like, what I promote the stuff that you guys tell me to promote on the radio, right? I'm the radio broadcaster. You're promoting all the stuff. But then there's certain things that it's like this, like, where I'm like, man, I love it so much. Like, it's not that I'm giving it any extra.
You sound like a little boy right now. You sound like a little boy so excited about it.
Yeah, it's cool.
Which is great.
I'm so glad. Like, it's so easy to work here. And people don't know that. That you just show up and you go to a game, you get a hot dog, you get a cold beer. I've been here for a long time. It's just an easy place to work, man. People are cool. Like, you know, you support the people that you work with. It's been that way since I got here. You know, I'm really proud of our organization. Just for being a business that I feel like cares about the people that work in the building.
Yeah, this is an escape of reality for those that are coming to the game as fans.
Yeah.
But for you and I and the rest of the hardworking staff here in the front office, you know, we're the ones that are making those experiences for everyone, and it is really fun. You know, the age-old quote about, you know, if you like your job, you never work a day in your life.
Yes,
sure.
I mean, don't you feel like that? I mean, look, we work long hours.
Yeah, there's tough days. Trust me, there's very long hours, and a lot of those are happening right now. You know, in preparation for the season. But, you know, at the end of the day, it's all about, like, wow, look at me. You know, I get to come here. I see this beautiful view of this green grass, this great field, and we come and watch baseball for 69 games this spring and summer. It's pretty nice.
Well, 69 for you, and you know,
and for you going on the road.
Yeah, I'm with the team most of the time, you know. But look, guys, I probably should say this a little bit more, but this is Wild Pitches. Aris and Mick right here. Like and follow at Smokies Baseball. We're gonna have George Yardley coming up here soon. The
what
voice.
A treat!
Yeah, going Yardley is the segment. But let's switch gears. Let's stay with our promotion schedule here. On a deep dive for our first ever podcast, Margaritaville night, May 27th.
Talk about even more musical entertainment and more drinking. How about that?
Everything I love. Music, drinking, and baseball, right?
What a treat. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is something that's been a staple at Smokies Stadium since before I was here for many years. People just love the opportunity of living in a tropical paradise. Not actually in paradise. We're here in Kodak, Tennessee. And, you know, it's a matter of interpretation of what's paradise, but in my opinion, I think Margaritaville is the place I'd rather be every single day. You know, my shoes off, you know, just relaxing, enjoying a cold beverage on the beach, getting tan. I mean, how can you complain about that? And so our goal here every year is to try to replicate that at least a little bit for those that come out to the ballpark.
Yeah, it's been a big part of the promotion schedule too, even before I got here. Mm-hmm. What's cool is this offseason I went to Key West, and it was kind of a business pleasure trip, you know, but
business pleasure.
Yeah, it was like business, like where I was like kind of like recapping the year and what, you know, like kind of the way that I wanted things to go this year. And at the same time, I also wanted to, have some fun too while I was doing that. You know, talking about all the different stuff that's going on and kind of. And one of the bartenders had a place called Blue Heaven, which is this amazing restaurant in Key West. I'm talking about the type of place that there's lines to get in there.
Yeah.
And, you know, like, the food's amazing. I slipped into the bar during happy hour, and when the place opened, I'm like, I'll take the, you know, the red-tailed snapper, the yellow-tailed snapper with the special sauce, you know, in there.
Door. Yeah.
But the bartender, who's a really cool dude, worked at Margaritaville when Jimmy Buffett owned it.
Wow.
And was there, and he knew him, and we were just, you know, he'd been there for a long time, and we were just kind of talking about how the Margaritaville brand was built, and what kind of guy Jimmy Buffett was, and you guys know, maybe you don't, you know, I live in Montrose, Alabama, in the same neighborhood that Jimmy Buffett lived. So
that's a
pretty cool, right
there.
But
yeah.
I mean, we're right on the water, and you know, I love the songs that he sings about. He lived in other places too. I think his sister Lulu has a restaurant in Gulf Shores called Lulu's. It's a great place. And when I take the boat, you can get to it by boat.
Yeah.
So we'll, you know, like Bloody Mary or, you know, some wings or beer, you know, whatever. I took Frank there last year. You know,
oh, man.
I took him. We just pull up.
That's why I've never seen him again.
Yeah, he's gone. He got eaten by a land shark. Just kidding. It ate his larynx.
Another story.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
For another day. But I actually was in the Floribama, which he wrote the song Bama Breeze about, right? And a lot of famous songs have been written. Kenny Chesney, who's from this area, wrote a song about the Floribama. And I'm there, and we're talking about Jimmy Buffett and just kind of what he represents. And this guy says to me, he's like, hey man, I wrote a book. I got to know his family, and he's like, and you live in Montrose. Like, you live in his neighborhood. They start talking about it. So he lived in Mobile, and he lived in other places. I think Pascagoula too, maybe. But it's just cool, like, you know, kind of like, my town is so small, such a small part of Fairhope, to think that at one point, you know, Jimmy Buffett's hanging out, you know, and writing songs.
It's
about
a weird thing to think about.
Pirates and, you know, and all this. But he had moved to Key West. And a lot of the success that he had started as a guy that was playing guitar at some of these places like Captain Tony's, where I watched Dallas play Tampa Bay in the playoffs this year. And
you say that like that carries a lot of weight.
Yeah, it was great. Well, like, do you remember Mike Leach, the football coach
of course.
Mississippi? We lost him. That was his hangout.
Oh,
so I went in there, and you know, and he had kind of become like a regular, at Captain Tony's, and I walked in, and I said, it was a great atmosphere. And then they're telling me about Jimmy Buffett would come in there and just play guitar, and you know, and he wrote a lot of his songs about stuff that happened there. So we have at the stadium, we've really captured that kind of that vibe for that night. You know, and there were years where, you know, one of the guys from the Coral Reefer Band would fly in and actually do the concert.
Right.
It was like one of the guys playing. So.
Well, Mick, I mean, I think you're omitting one of the most important parts of Margaritaville Night, and that's when you and your posse. They decide
to... I totally forgot about that.
How could you forget? You're such a liar.
I swear.
You are not forgetting about that.
I was not.
Mick and his posse, and he's a group of hardworking interns, you know, that help put together the broadcast for the television and the radio for the games. Before the game, they get to go down onto the field, and they dress up in various characters that you might see in this cartoon version of Margaritaville,
like
a parrot or a shark or I don't know, a lot of
anything
other
that we
different
can get,
things.
Any costume that we can get a hold of, we'll wear. So, dude, I'm so glad you brought that up, man. Like, I forgot, and I swear I wasn't even thinking.
How
about
could
that.
You not?
I don't know.
You know?
Like, I just
and the dance to go along with this performance.
There's this guy that we had that worked here named Charlie Walter. And this guy, I met him in Montgomery. He did TV in Montgomery, and then eventually he was out of TV and he needed a job. And people are begging me to hire him. They're begging me. Didn't work in TV. He's back in TV. He's actually a big time TV sports guy in San Francisco now, right? But so he shows up, and I'm like, this guy, he's like.
A freak?
He's so enthusiastic about everything. You know what I mean? Like, we're so much just like so enthusiastic. So it was the years that we did, we had a show on Fox here locally.
Yeah.
Called Bear Tracks, right? And so the second season of Bear Tracks, he produced it. And so since he had been a TV, he knew how to do all that stuff. Well, he would come to me and he'd be like, hey, you know, we should do this. And it was always like something that was like demeaning to my personality.
Oh, that's so nice of him.
So I love it. Yeah, I love it. Like, it's like, okay, you know what? I'll dress up in a Hawaiian shirt with a big floppy hat on and go out on the field and we'll play music and we'll dance like we have like this. The whole thing is like we go out there.
Fins to the left, fins to the right.
We go out there. Yeah. Like we have, like we're a real dance troupe. And then we're awful.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, turn your attention behind home plate.
I know. And
Mick
I'll
and his Galapagos Island buddies.
I know. And you know, some years the kids want, you know, the guys want to do it. You know, they want to do it. Some years I'm like, hey, we're just doing this. But that first year, we did it for the TV show.
Yeah.
And it was, and actually, he was actually like the choreographed it. It was pretty good. And then it's progressively gotten worse.
The choreography is something that definitely needs to be worked on for years.
The drink specials and the cheeseburgers in paradise. Like, that's been, honestly, these events, and as we do this podcast about summer, I'm sure we'll talk about a bunch of other ones, but these are two of my favorites. And what makes them great is when you guys show up and you make them great. Like you're in your Jimmy Buffett outfits and you're like yelling salt when, you know, we're sitting in Margaritaville. And that's what makes it so cool. And so you sent me the itinerary today. It's not like I put this together, but with that said, well, these are two things I love. I'm passionate.
You know, I'm just that type of guy that want to cater to your needs. You know, just like every woman in your life, just catering to your needs or something.
All right. Well, look, we hit Grateful Dead night. That's July 8th. Margaritaville night is on May 27th. So make your plans now.
Circle those dates
circle.
On the calendar.
Who's the band? Who do we have? I know we got Stolen Faces for the Grateful Dead. Do you have a band yet?
That'd be the Very Jolly Island Party. So, nice. The dude is a staple here in East Tennessee when it comes to putting together those fun tropical vibes.
That's awesome. All right. Guys, as you hang out with us, don't forget, I want you to do us a solid. Like and follow at Smokies Baseball. Send us questions if you want us to talk about a topic on wild pitches.
Requests. Always taking requests.
Yeah, like, because eventually we'll do... This is, I'm going to give you a hint, this is not live. This is a podcast. We're talking live, but by the time you hear it, it'll be recorded. But as we move forward, I'm sure we'll do some live. But
sure.
We'd love to hear from any of you guys. And I guess, it, as they say, without further ado...
Oh, no.
It's time to go Yardley.
George, time to put that beer down. All right, I'll go carry him in. Yeah.
All right, I see
him over there. Why don't you tell the fans a little bit about the spectacle we're about to see?
Well, George started, actually, as the Smokies public address announcer when they were at Bill Meyer Stadium. And my first years coming to the ballpark, I was the visiting broadcaster with Chattanooga, and I remember being George and thinking, man, this guy... what a great personality, you know, like just a guy that makes you laugh, you know, like it's funny. And, you know, then eventually I got this job, and this guy's voice has echoed through the corridors at Smokies Stadium for years. And so it's always great to hear from him. Now, I saw him making notes over there, so I have no idea what that actually means note-wise, because we haven't told him anything that we're going to ask him about. But this segment is going to be Going Yardley. And I see you walking up here. So I guess Aris is off, and looks like you're going to jump in.
Need a ladder.
Just climb right on in. Let me go ahead and put the wide shot. Since you're on, I'll put the wide shot on.
Wide angle. Wide angle works best.
What's up, man?
Oh, nice. What a beautiful day. Gee whiz.
I think you took Aris' seat, but just go ahead and take it. I see that he's got company over there. Welcome to Wild Pitches. Have you been? What have you been doing over at the bar?
Studying my notes.
Studying your notes. So what did you? What do you want me to ask?
Well, since we're in a baseball stadium, how about some facts about Bill Meyer and Tennessee, Tennessee Smokies baseball?
Nah, not talking about that.
Okay, all right. Talking about your situation, baby?
No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, let's talk about Bill Meyer Stadium, because when I was in college, I used to drive through Knoxville on the way to get home, and that's actually when I became a fan of... you know, Tennessee's longtime, not the Smokies, but the Vols' longtime broadcaster, John Ward. I used to listen to football games when he would call them, and I thought that he was just amazing at the craft, you know, of calling football.
I'll tell you a good story about John Ward.
Sure.
He came up several years ago because Natural Gas was a sponsor one night. He's the voice, you know, Natural Gas. Mm-hmm. Was he he's up in one of the suites, and he's sitting down there. But Jeff, I go down there and meet him because he's going to have to come to the press box and do some advertising over the PA. Okay, so super nice guy. He comes in, I pulled him up the seat there behind the microphone, and he's looking at stuff, and he turns to me and he says, "Now you're going to have to tell me how to do this." And I thought,
no, come on.
I don't think so, John.
You've got to be kidding me.
I don't think so. No, no.
He was giving you a hard time. He was
serious. I thought, John Ford, you're asking me when you're the master behind the mic for the balls, but I'll always remember that. Now, I've got some great pictures with him, me and myself.
He was such a nice guy.
Yeah.
Was. Like, it was always cool when he showed up because, you know, he was such a big part of the community. And,
oh, yeah.
You know, he had great stories. And he loved baseball, too. Yeah, he told me he broadcasted baseball and, you know, done the Smokies in the past. So, and I think a lot of the local broadcasters, like, you know, the Bob Kesslings and him and Lindsey Nelson's and
Lindsey
stuff.
Nelson.
Like, you know, you jump in and do it when there's an opportunity.
Oh, yeah.
You know, there were there at Bill Meyer Stadium. You know, all those years ago, like those guys would get the chance to kind of do the play-by-play, which is what I do. I'm a sports animal, or you know, just on MILB TV, calling the games. I've been doing it for a long time. But to think about those guys that had that same job before me, Tom Hart, you know, is the voice of SEC. Pretty cool.
Yeah, it is. And Bill Meyer, we brought that up. It has a rich tradition, rich history. You know, that stadium has been in that same location. They started out as Caswell Park, then they renamed it Smithson Stadium after a councilman in Oxford, and then it went to Municipal Stadium. They built the present Bill Meyer, but it was Municipal Stadium until 57, from 53 to 57. And then they renamed it Bill Meyer after a Knoxvillian, native Knoxvillian, who played in the major leagues and managed a long time. Managed, well, I don't know how long, but he managed for the Pirates for several years. And that was where he came back after he retired from baseball and lived in Knoxville and died and was buried in Knoxville. So that's the old Bill Meyer that we left in 99.
Well, you've been the voice of people when they come through the corridors, right? They can come through those hallways, which are pretty blustery today. There's a lot of wind out there.
Gee.
You know, you're announcing names and stuff. Look, I really think that your job is tough because it's tough to pronounce everyone's name correct.
That's true. Goodness knows I've had tied more than once. So. Yeah, I usually have a question.
You get back on, Aris?
No, please. No. I was thinking of you.
I'll come to you or to the visiting play-by-play guy, but now so many times you don't have the play-by-play guys. Not many of those guys go on the road.
Right.
So, you know, you got to just do kind of roll the flow and do the best you can with some of the names.
Yeah, look, and that's kind of the way that the business is now, too, is that it's changed. You know, like where you don't have to necessarily travel. You can do games from the studio or, you know, a lot of it's crazy to me that the Birmingham Barons do the road games on radio.
Yeah.
And I'm not taking a shot at them, but if I was a fan of the team, I just want to have my guy calling the action.
Sure,
right?
Sure. I just, you know, sometimes change is not for the better. I just, I'm a traditionalist and an old school guy. You know, just used to have me a visiting team in the booth next to me, between you and me, and doing the play-by-play. And it's just not happening with everybody in the Southern League. It's unfortunate.
Well, George, what's the thing that you enjoy most about coming to the stadium?
I would say probably fans. We've got a great fan base here, and I really, really like today. I've had people come up to me and talk.
Are you brown nosing right now?
I am, as you know. And I'm really.
I'm just kidding.
It's really satisfying to see these people, especially some of these kids. That know who you are and know what you do. It's I'm a fan guy, and I just enjoy the folks that you see, the season ticket holders day in, day out. So that's very satisfying. I enjoy that part of the game. Plus, I've got the best seat in the house. You know, if you're a fan, you sit where I do, you don't miss a thing. So that's enjoyable, being a big baseball fan. That adds to my pleasure.
I agree with you, man. Like, and we've talked about this before, and I was saying this to Aris, is just how this is such a great place to work, you know, and it's ownership all the way down, and the fans, we had the best fans. I really do think we had the best fans in baseball. You know, the most frustrating part when you know, last year the Smokies came up a game short, is that this team hasn't won a championship on the field since 1978. I wish the Cubs would make that a priority to get that done for the fans, because these people have supported this team and they deserve a winner, a champion, you know, and there's only eight teams in the league now, you know, and it's like, when you're moving guys up or sitting on the bench in AAA, let them stay down here. Let's do something that we haven't accomplished. It's the second longest drought in the minor leagues.
Yeah.
And the way that this team is supported, they deserve a winner.
And I was there. You brought up 78.
Yeah, 1978.
Yeah. That was my first year of coaching high school baseball. And I was a big Smokies fan then, as I have been since 1953. But anyway, so I go to the final game. This is the championship game for it all. We had a box seat right behind the Smokies dugout. Well, the Smokies win it all. And of course, they rush the field, and they're out at the pitcher's mound. And I thought, oh, I'm going to go celebrate myself. So I got on top of the dugout, jumped over the rail, and got right out to the pitcher's mound. And I'm, you know,
I would love to have a video.
Yeah. That would be so. Anyway, so I'm out there celebrating everything, you know, just happy as could be. And I suddenly looked around and realized that I was the only person out there that didn't have on a uniform to include a blue uniform of five of Knoxville's finest policemen, who quickly escorted me to the first base gate. So in other words, I was tossed after the
you
gate.
You got thrown out, huh?
Yeah, I got tossed.
Well, it's probably not the first time you've been tossed out of a fine establishment.
To make it more embarrassing, that game was on Saturday or Sunday. Anyway, so I go back to school on Monday, and three of my players came up to me and said, "Coach, we saw you at the game yesterday." And I thought, why didn't you come up and speak to me? You were out on the field celebrating.
And thrown
so,
out.
So, yeah.
Carter High baseball.
That's it. So, great memories.
Yeah.
Great memories.
Well, it's 2023. You know, there's a new ballpark that will eventually be taking over for Smokies Stadium. So it's this year and next year, I guess, is the game plan. This place has been special, man. I mean, like, you can't deny that we haven't had, despite the fact that there's been a lot of teams that have come up short here, the environment has been fun, the atmosphere has been fun. Like, I think these next 2 years are going to be really fantastic. I mean, and I'm not just saying that because we're doing the Smokies podcast. I mean, you know that off the air, I'd say the same thing.
Oh, yeah, I agree. I really do. Okay. You know, especially if we put together a team like we had last year, it would make it even more enjoyable for the fans. But I really, really
there's a part of life. I remember as a kid watching Memorial Stadium go in Baltimore, you know, and that's why growing up going to games. And then Camden Yards came, and it's like, Camden Yards never replaced Memorial Stadium to me. As far as like the memories that I had as a kid, you know, running up the giant turnstile and looking out and seeing Eddie Murray and Cal Ripken, you know, taking infield and just how green the grass is at a baseball stadium and to get there and the excitement. But business wise, and Camden Yards is special too. Now they never won a series at Camden Yards. They won a bunch at Memorial Stadium. You know. But I think that it's going to be, both places are great. So I think that it's probably what we're looking at here. Let's really take advantage of the fact that we have 2 more years in the stadium and make those the best 2 years that we can possibly make.
Agree. I'm ready to go, and I think a lot of the fans, I heard some fans talking earlier about how anxious they are for Thursday night to get here. So that's what we're looking for. We're looking to do the 69 game home stand right here. And hopefully we'll have an early spring. We'll have to wear long johns Thursday night and go with it.
It's been some cold games out here. broadcast, I don't know, you guys put the window down. You're not like us. We put the window up. It doesn't matter what the temperature is.
Window stays up.
The
one in front of me.
You keep it up?
No, yes. I've never had a game that I've had the window down. I've had some guys beside of me that aren't happy.
Aren't happy about that.
No, I'm serious.
Kidding. So you keep it up, so you're the guy in the booth, and they're like, put the window down, man. Yeah. It's freezing right now.
Yeah, put your gloves on. Put your long handles on. Yeah. But the window's up.
Well, you don't have Bernie to kick around anymore.
We don't have Bernie to kick around anymore.
Bernie was in the press box forever. When I first got here, we had this crew in the press box that was just great. Skip, Bernie. Eventually, Wade slid in there.
Yeah.
Go back, right?
Wade's still
right.
Yeah. Still with.
Listen to anybody. Aaron Hedrick was part of the crew there for a minute.
Yeah, there. Yeah.
Forgot. He's the play-by-play guy. Touchdown. But what a good bunch of guys.
Oh yeah. Yeah. And you're sitting up there. You see it all. You see it all. From my perspective, right by my home plate. One of the fun things is I see, and I've done this quite often, I see somebody in the stands and I know, and it's just call them out on the PA, and it really blows your mind. I've had a lot of fun out with that.
I've had a lot of fun too. Well, look, I mean, we're at 45 minutes. Is there anything else that you want to talk about on the show before we wrap things up, or did we hit it all?
Well, I just would invite the fans, if you can't make it Thursday, go away.
Can you do it in, well, hold on, can you do it in a way where you're like, if you were over the PA, just to give people a taste of, like, what would it be like if they were at the stadium?
Fans, don't forget Thursday night is opening night, first bits of 15, against the Birmingham Barons. Come on up and join us on Thirsty Thursday.
That's right, Thirsty Thursday. And that's when the season gets started this Thursday. Hey, thanks for hanging out with us, Aris and Mick and George. We're going Yardley. This is the first episode of Wild Pitches. But guys, be a part of this. We're doing this for you. Like and follow at Smokies Baseball. Make your comments. We're going to get back together again here next week. We're going to do this throughout the season. We're going to have a lot of fun, and you're coming back for more.
Yes.
Your segment's called Going Yard. You like that?
I like that. I do.
All right. Well, look, that does it for us here. FanFest 2023. Thanks, all of you guys, for being a part of the show, and we'll see you real soon.